Good morning, and I'm really honored to be here for Bose, 125 Bose, and thanks to the main organizer for inviting me here. I was here 15 years ago, and it's really nice to be back. So my talk will try to be between mathematics and physics, hoping that will not be neither mathematics nor physics. So so this is a few papers. Credits are at the beginning. So few papers that I've been writing with a few people, and more recently with Franz Lueff, with applications in Gabor analysis, of which I will not tell much today, but if anybody is interested, I can, of course, talk about that. And I will talk about the Moyal plane, but rather in this exponential form, which goes under the name of irrational rotation algebra, and is one of the incarnation of the, also these things, of the non-commutative torus. And so sigma model solidons on both these two spaces, and the simplest example is that the target space is made of two points, while the source space will be one of these non-commutative spaces. So from a commutative point of view, the theory does not exist. I mean, it's empty. And there is an action functional, which is very natural, and there will be self-duality equations, and with a lower bound on some Chern number. And there will be solutions. I will explicitly construct solutions via Morita equivalence by models. And in the particular case of both Moyal plane and the ERA, this will come from a suitable use of the Schrödinger representation. More general model, for instance, on quantum two spheres can also be constructed, and many of these concepts can be twisted by some automorphism, so there will be everything be twisted in a suitable manner. So there will be, but most probably I won't be able to talk about these twisted things, and but still there is a lot of things that one can do in also in the theorem of quantum groups. You see, just this is probably just to show what kind of things this Gabor analysis people do. That you start with L2 of R, and then you have what is called the Gabor frame. So these are these operators E and T. And there are two main operators. One is the translation operator, and one is the modulation operator. Essentially, these TX and EW, they close up the ERA algebra, so the non-commutative torus algebra. And the energy functional which I will construct will be, in this case, will be something like that. And so and this will be then a functional for projection in some suitable manner. And it seems is bounded from below by a Chern number in this particular case, or something more sophisticated. And there will be solutions like Gaussians, just the simplest solution, or maybe something a little bit more sophisticated. So just to put the things in context, so what is a usual what is a usual nonlinear sigma model? So the configuration space, this is maps between the source space, so a Riemannian manifold, and a target space, another Riemannian manifold. And this is the usual action functional. And so the stationary points, from a mathematical point of view, these are harmonic maps from sigma to M. And minimal surfaces, which are embedded into M. Of course, almost everybody in the audience knows the use of this kind of object also in string theories, for instance. Now, if sigma is dimension 2, there is conformal invariance. So conformal invariance means that the action is invariant if you rescale the metric. And so it depends only on the conformal class of the metric. And using a complex structure on sigma, you can write it like that. There is a delta and delta bar operator. And this will be your complex structure. In two-dimension, conformal and the complex are the same thing. And so that you up to a conformal factor, the metric that you use is something like that. There is a parameter tau. but most of the talk for this parameter, which is the imaginary part of the parameter is positive, will be just I, tau equal I, but many things, exactly, everything can be really done in more general case, and we'll get a more sophisticated moduli space of this object, which will depend also on tau. Okay, now, we have to dualize this thing. Since spaces are traded for functions, but some of the things are easy to dualize. I mean, instead of having spaces, we have algebras, so A and B. So the embedding of sigma into M will dually correspond to star algebra morphisms between A, B, and between B and A. So the configuration space of the things that I'm playing with will be just star algebra morphisms from an algebra to another algebra. But if you want to define the action functional, then you need more stuff, in particular Riemannian geometry and conformal geometry. Now, in two dimensions, there is this work of Cohn and Kuntz, where you think of the conformal structure in the framework of positive Hochschild cohomology. What does it mean here? So you have an object that is, this is a technically a cyclic cocycle, so this is an integral. So you integrate forms. So this object here is the fundamental class of sigma, so something which does not depend on the metric. But in the same Hochschild cohomology class, there is a positive object, which is written like here, which depends on the metric. In fact, depends on the conformal structure. So you extract this object, and this is your way to encode the metric. And in particular, the fact that it's positive, this allows you to construct a scalar product on one form. So there is something which does not depend on the metric, so you integrate objects, and there is something in the same cohomology class, Hochschild cohomology class, which is positive and it depends on the conformal structure. And the interplay between these two will be given this lower bound on the action functional, and this I will use these things to construct, to integrate curvature, to construct topological numbers with a trace, with a suitable trace. Okay, now, expressions like phi and psi, they make sense in general. They make sense in general for any general algebra. Yeah, let me just skip these things here, but the kind of action functional formally will be something like that. So it's pi here will be this conformal, this morphism, and then g will be some fixed metric, an object in universal two form in this case, and then there will be essentially some integral. So I will be a little bit more explicit on these kind of things. So this will be formally the non-commutative analog of the action function. So the dynamical variable, like I said, the dynamical variable is pi, and then phi will be the conformal structure, and g will be the metric on the target. These are background that I will not move over there. And the critical point of this object will be minimal embedded surfaces in the non-commutative space associated to B, whatever this non-commutative space is, this virtual space. And I say, a topological charge will come out of the cosine. The simplest example, really. So two points as a target space, like I said, 1, 2. Any continuous map from any surface sigma to this discrete space will be trivial. So like I said, a commutative theory is not there. But dually there is a lot of stuff, because as the algebra will be C2, the algebra on these two points will be C2, and then this algebra here is generated by a projection, the one that say, okay, one on the first point is 1, on the second point is 0, So any star algebra morphism is the same as a projection. So the configuration space is just the set of all projections in an algebra A. So you can even forget the, whatever I've done up to here. So you can restart with projection in some algebra. And the projections are important for several reasons. So projections are bundles, projections are Grassmann connections. So there is a lot of geometry that you can do out of them. And so the action functional will be something like that. Okay, something formally will be something like that. Again, the positivity in the Hochschild cohomology will impose that this is bounded by topology. The structure, really, the structure is this. Both for torus, both for Moyal, both also for this the Podolish, that you have an algebra, you have an integral, which I'm writing here as a trace, and then you have two derivations. You have two derivations, and then you have some conformal, some complex structure on A, which in the simplest thing, I will just write using this I. So that this essentially this is telling you that you have an action of a complex torus, on your algebra. A is an invariant trace, and so you have these things that you start with. It's so like I said, say in general you have this. You can take any complex number here with the imaginary part greater than zero. So if you just play a little bit with this action and then you be careful of the fact that you have projections, you can write the critical point and you get something like that, that the Laplacian of your metric is to commute with your projection. So this will be the critical point of this functional. Something which is nice looking, but it's actually quite complicated because it is second order, and so it's non-linear, so it's rather complicated. So one of the things that one does is pretty much like it happens, for instance, Young Mills. So you have this bound here. So what is it, this object? So you have the cyclic 2 cos angle, which was given before. So if you just use it against the projection, then this object is an integer. So this object is an integer. In fact, this is the index of a Fredholm operator. Here you are just integrating. This is essentially A commutator with A1 commutator with A2. So it's really actually similar to your talk, where you had this kind of similar expressions. You have the trace of an object with gammas, and then there was a commutator. So it was similar to this kind of thing. So this object is a topological number. So this is a Fest-Chern number of the bundle. Which bundle? Is the bundle of your projection. So your projection is a bundle, and so this bundle here is classified up to something by this number. One shows that the positivity between of these objects and the interplay within these Hochschild things is that the action functional is always greater or equal to the absolute values of C1 of P. So exactly, so this is Young-Mills. So imagine the Young-Mills functional, and imagine the trace F wedge F. So here this will be the trace of F star F, and this will be the trace of FF. So this is the similar things. And the equality here is exactly when your P satisfies the self-duality or anti-self-duality equation. Okay? So plus or minus self-dual or anti-self-dual. So this object here will be, these are first order. So again, they are not easy, but they are easier than the previous one. And so is the kind of object that now I will study. And and the solution I will call sigma model solution, solitons. I will actually look for object which a physicist Dirac, I mean the counterpart of Bose, bosons and fermions, will write it as a bracket. Okay? But now these brackets are not object in some Hilbert space or its dual, but are rather in what is an Hilbert module. So the coefficients are not numbers, but rather are algebras. And so this will be, if you want, some kind of field theory Hilbert space, or maybe even a rigged Hilbert space has been used in the physics literature. So what is this object? What is this kind of object? So you have in mind formally an Hilbert space, and instead of having a number C, you just have an algebra.
Can I just ask, when you call it a soliton, are you trying to draw a distinction between that and an instanton, or is it the same thing?
I mean, it's the same thing in this case. I mean, instanton is more appropriate in four dimensions, maybe, but yeah. What I want to say is that these objects they come in batches, and each is a label, which is a topological number. Okay, so whenever I say the module, you just think of Hilbert module, you just think of an Hilbert space. So there is here E, which is a bimodule. There is an algebra which acts on the left and an algebra which acts on the right. Okay, so this will be okay. Technically, for the moment, I'll forget about it. There is a left linear evaluated Hermitian product, the dot is on the left. There is a right linear b-valued Hermitian product, and there is this condition here. So they are compatible in this sense. I mean, in the previous, suppose this is a bracket, bra, sorry, suppose this is a cat bar, cat, bra, on another cat, it's a number, and then you get the starting cat. So it's really, this is really something that in physics we are used all the time, okay? Object of the form, left here, these are actually in the Hilbert space picture, these will be compact operators, okay? Here, these are compact endomorphisms, okay? And so you can identify the left, the right here, the right algebra with the compact endomorphism, so linear objects over A, linear operator which are on E, which linearity now with respect to the functions, and which are the kind of compact operator. In particular, if I can break. In particular, if my E is projective of finite type, if I can break the one, okay, of one of the algebra, then with the dot on the right, then the object with the dot on the other side, this is a projection, okay? This is a projection in typically matrices over the other algebra. So it's this kind of object that I will try to construct. And the Riffel puts these things in the context of what is called Morita equivalence. So A and B are Morita equivalent algebra. So this means that they topologically they are the same thing. Okay, so you cannot distinguish them. So I was essentially integrating curvatures, so in fact I have a connection. So, but I need then these two derivatives, delta 1 and delta 2, so both A and B will carry these two derivatives. They are not exactly the same because I have to take care of some normalization so that they are actually proportional to the... So if you fix them in one, then in the other one you need something which is proportional. And then there will be traces, and the traces will be compatible in the sense that if I take the trace of an object which is lands in the one algebra, it is the trace of the same object when it's landing on the other algebra. In this context, I mean, in the context of this module, it makes sense to talk about covariant derivatives, so pretty much like we do it in general relativity. So this is a map from in to in, which will be Leibniz rules on the, for the left action, and right Leibniz rule for the right action. So when you go through, you just remove, you put A outside, but then of course you get an extra term, which is the derivative of the A. A and B are element in the algebra, and while Xi is an element in the bundle. And they are also metric compatibility in this more generalized sense. So if we were talking about Hilbert space, is one of these objects will be numbers, so we'll just take the fact that the covariant derivative is compatible with the metric, so this will be zero here. Only one, actually, the other one will not be zero, because the other one will be really compact operator. So, but this is the usual metric compatibility written in this abstract sense. And I can lift also the complex structure by using the I. I mean, I add these complex derivations, I can actually lift it to this combination of the covariant derivative. If I take as an example the rank one case, so the rank one case means that I have only one vector, psi psi dot is equal to one, and so that psi psi dot in the other algebra, it's a projection. So the fact that this is one, this is a projection. And the equations for this P will be these things here, and they are solutions. This something like that is a solution of this equation if there is some function lambda, so that this object here is just holomorphic up to this function. So this object here looks like a Gaussian equation by the form of, for instance, it will depend of course on the derivative that I have, but in some simplest example this is some kind of Gaussian equation, but in more general situation is something more complicated. The curvature makes sense. And the curvature in this case is just the commutator of these two covariant derivatives. Since delta 1 and delta 2, the derivation commute, there would be an extra term here, minus delta of the commutator, which is not there. And if I work out the Chern number of the projection that the Chern number before of this projection, then I will get something like that. Now this has to be an integer. This has to be an integer, but for instance, in the case of a constant curvature connection, you will get something like that. So your number will be a Q, which is your curvature, and then the trace of one, which is something that has to match, and so that this is a number. For instance, on the non-commutative torus, there are connections for which the curvature is something like theta 1 minus r, something like that, where theta is this deformation parameter. So the trace has to be such that everything is an integer. So there are sophisticated playing between these two things. Okay, so example of this construction. So I start with the projective representation of R2 on L2, which is defined like that. I mean, there is a shift here on one variable, and there is a phase. And then this is actually a projective representation, so that in fact you get something which is a phase, and which is in fact a two cocycle. A two cocycle that you can use to construct some twisted convolution. In this the matrix coefficient of this representation will be object like that. They are used in this Gabor analysis. They are called short time Fourier transform. So this kind of object are used there. And so this object here is really the Moyal identity, and so this is at the level of, this is really the Moyal product, written in some integrated form and written in some, as a twisted convolution. You see here you have a twisted convolution for which you use this cosagon. And you have also a twisted involution, and in fact this object here is really essentially this object here is the Moyal product. The Moyal product on some class of symbols. So if you take the Fourier transform of some class of symbol, you get really the integral version of the Moyal plane. I mean, you can do in several fashion, either as a twisted convolution or maybe as a star product. So these are essentially the same. The compact operator being Morita equivalent to C. So A is the Moyal plane algebra, and C is just the complex number. So you take as a bimodule the Schwarz function on R. There is an action on the left by an element into A, and this is these things here. There is an action on the right. So of course this is C. I can make it act on the left and on the right. But I want to distinguish, so I will have a right action of C, which is just multiplication by maybe the bar here. There are A valued Hermitian product, which is written explicitly like that. And this is just these coefficients that I was writing before, and then they are represented in this space here. And of course, the other one is simply L2 product. And this object here is a Morita equivalence bimodule between A and C. This is the statement that the compact operators, so when you close this algebra into the sister algebra, compact operators and C, they are Morita equivalent. So in particular, this is another fact that the compact operator is up to a reducible, the only one reducible representation up to unitary equivalence. And so on this object, there is a two-dimensional spectral geometry. I mean, these people, many people have been working on the Dirac operator on this Moyal plane. Varilli, Thomas Schuker, Jochum, and somebody else. Victor Geral, in fact, this was actually probably the Geral thesis. They construct the Dirac operator and the spectral triple on this Moyal plane. This is a different way, and everything is done via two derivations. Which comes from an infinitesimal action of the torus, and here is in this framework what these two derivations are. I mean, this is a very simple object. You can lift this geometry to the equivalence bimodule, and you have these two operator, nabla 1 and nabla 2, which are compatible with respect to both left and right Hermitian structure. They lift this derivative and so on. And in this case, the connection has constant curvature. You see, this is really this is really, I mean, this is just Heisenberg representation. I mean, okay, so this is just nabla 1 and nabla 2, this you just take the derivative or you just multiply, and then you get that they commute. I mean, this is, I could put H barrier, or I could, so essentially this is really Heisenberg accumulation relation. In this case, usual Gaussians here, with let's say generalized Gaussian with lambda being a number, these are solution of course of this equation here, nabla bar was nabla 1 plus I nabla 2, and these are actually in turn a way to express that the corresponding projection is a solution of my self-duality equation, so the corresponding projection is a soliton, and in the framework of this Gabor analysis, this object here, this is really a projection, and this projection here, so you can use it to label different sectors in these Gabor frames, and these are coming with this topological charge. So if you compute C1 of these, it's 1, because really the trace here is not, well, the trace is, in this case, actually, the trace is 1, and you have to normalize by, everything is in the unit of 2 pi I. So in this case, it's similar. So in fact, that's what I wrote. I mean, the constant curvature is, in this case, it's just the Heisenberg commutation relations. And so this object is really the annihilation operator, and this object here is the creation operator. So this is also another way to write what TRG and Sachin were writing, Morni Sachin were writing yesterday, that the modal plane actually using an annihilation and a creation operator. It's only done at the level of integrated. In this case, the interpretation is, of course, that the self-duality equation is, for this class of object, is just something that has to minimize the Heisenberg uncertainty relations of these Gaussians. So let's go to something more sophisticated. Francesco, how am I doing? 10 minutes? No, 10 minutes.
A bit more than that.
Okay. So, if I take theta to be any number, but mainly rational, and then the corresponding non-commutative torus, again you can actually do it in many manner, but it's in fact you just restrict the Schrödinger representation that I was writing at the very beginning. The Schrödinger representation that I was writing here, okay, which is the usual projective representation of R2, if you just, you can do two things. You can do two things, and you can you start with restricting it to theta z cross z, and then you have these two generators here, m1 and t theta, which is also the form of the Gabor frame at the beginning, and they satisfy this non-commutative torus algebra. I mean, u1 u2 is equal to a phase u2 u1, and of course, so this will be the sister algebra. And the smooth algebra, you just save to control the coefficients of an expansion. So you expand in powers of these two generators, and so the coefficient must be some Schwarz function of Z2 in this case. So in fact, you see, this is a way, once again, to represent the twisted convolution. So the twisted convolutions where you have these extra terms which comes from theta being there. If this is not zero, you go back to the usual convolution, and this is the just the Fourier analysis of smooth functions on connectors. You have also a star operation, and then you look for the commutant. From the commutant of this algebra, and the commutant turns out to be something which is labeled by this other lattice here, and so the algebra will be exactly like before, but now you have, in fact, instead of having theta, you have 1 over theta, and so this will be these two algebra will commute. In fact, rather than this, I will actually take the opposite algebra so that I want to act from the right. Again, left action from A theta and right action from A to minus 1 over theta. And this is the simplest example of a Morita equivalence between two non-commutative torus. More generally, you go from a theta and you go to something which is transformed by an element in SL2Z. But in this case, this is the simplest possibility. And in fact, again, now the same space, so Schwarz functions of one variable, it's an equivalence by model between these two non-commutative torus. You can write explicit the left action, the right action, the Hermitian product, I mean left valued and the right valued, and so that everything matches, and these two products are compatible in the previous sense of this Moyal, so that if I multiply this object here with another object, this is the same thing, I mean this more the same thing as multiplying it on the other. On the other thing, so this there was this this product that I was writing before. So it's this so left. So this is xi eta and z, and this is the same as xi eta xi. So this associativity. So these are Morita equivalence. In fact, they also this kind of idea is also been using in string theory in T-duality. I mean, in the language of T-duality, these two algebras will be T-dual, and you may think of them as to use it for D-brains even, for instance. There is a two-dimensional spectral geometry on both algebras. So there is in fact a spectral triple on all these algebras, which was really constructed long ago by Kohn, essentially by Kohn and also maybe Riffel. So there are these derivations for one algebra. This is the phenomenon that I was telling you before. You have to normalize. You have to normalize the derivative on one side, otherwise they don't match. You can lift them to covariant derivatives, so nabla 1 and nabla 2 on this bimodule, which are of the form like before. So here nabla 1 is the multiplication by the argument, and nabla 2 is the derivative. So it's essentially exactly what I was doing before. Only now this will be covariant derivative for this module E thought of as a bimodule between the non-commutative torus and the non-commutative torus. And in this case, the curvature is constant, but there is this theta here. You see, from the rank point of view, this object here is rank theta. So it's a rank which is irrational. So it's something really, really totally non-commutative. I mean, this object here, and this is essentially a line bundle whose rank is theta. So it's a vector bundle, in fact, whose rank is theta. Theta could be irrational. And in fact now, I mean, you, the theta you get it also, you, you get it in the curvature. In the curvature and where, in fact, and then everything is really okay because now the trace of this operator will be exactly theta, the effect of the fact that this, the rank of this object is theta, and so everything is cancelled so that this is an integer. You can do something more general, and this is these are called frames, and so there's something that we were talking about this morning. So again, you can, instead of having only one object, you have a bunch of objects, eta 1, eta n, eta 1, eta n, and so that you can express any object in this module as a linear combination of these, and again, using this eta, I can construct a projection, because from that formula, if I just take, so if I just take in the other, so eta k, eta l, in the other algebra, this object is a projection. So again, can use this kind of things. Okay, but then you can construct all sort of frames in the algebra. In the algebra itself, one has to be careful about the. One has probably to restrict the values of the parameters. But essentially, one can, there exists explicit objects. There is this explicit object eta 1, eta n in the algebra itself, and so by suitable normalization, which is not obvious in general because these are functions, you can construct something which is of norm 1, and so you get that the other object is a projection. For instance, if you restrict your theta between 0 and k plus 1 to the minus 1, the Hermite function of this form here will give a projection, and this projection, or unfortunately this k here is, yeah, okay, they give projections, and this projection have all of them have a charge 1 essentially. And also there are other classes which are, totally positive function of finite type greater than 2, there is all sort of object that you can construct. Let me not write them explicitly. And again, some kind of t-duality relation, Morita equivalence relations that in the context of this Gabor analysis called Wechsler-Ratz identity, so that you can pass from one side to the other. I mean, so that you can construct projection in one algebra while using the something in the other algebra. So let me go back to this projection here. I want them to be solutions of this equation here. So PDP is equal to 0, which I already told you they translate to something like the nabla bar of psi being proportional to psi via a function. Lambda is not a number, it's a function. It's a function now. And so you can show that if you construct your projection using one of these Hermite functions here, then you have a solution of this equation. So you have to restrict the values of theta, exactly like before. So these are solution of this projection. These are projections which are solution of this equation. So from this, so I will call them solitons on this sigma model solitons on this non-commutative torus. In particular, you have usual Gaussians, where now lambda is a number, And still it's not easy because even if you write this object, you still need to invert. You still need to invert the function in the other algebra, which is not obvious that you can do. And in fact, it took a lot of work, and many people contributed to showing that this kind of objects are invertible, so they can be used to reconstruct, for instance, signals, or to be in my context, to be used to construct an object which is normalized, so that the projection is a solution of this equation. And one nice thing is that the study of the full moduli space is complicated. But for instance, if you take such Gaussian solutions, you have the notion of gauge transformations, and these gauge transformations, these are implemented by invertible element in your algebra. So this will be the analog of a complex gauge transformation. So not only unitaries, but more general invertible elements. So if you do this Gaussian up to gauge transformations, then you get a copy of the complex torus. So the moduli space of these Gaussians is a copy of the complex torus, which is reminiscence of the fact that if you do gauge theories and then if you take the moduli space of set-duality connections, then you get the boundary of this object, you get, for instance, the S4 from which you start. So you get something for that. I'm afraid I have to wind up. So applications, but there are more examples in application, more examples like SS also for Podlesch spheres and quantum projective spaces of the kind that, for instance, that Francesco was mentioning, where it's more complicated because in that case you have to twist, you have a natural twist in the algebra. Anyhow, let me just kind of summarize. So sigma model solidons over the modal plane and the non-commutative torus and maybe other spheres and other things. The target space is made of two points. There is an action functional, which self-duality equations, solutions coming from Morita equivalence bimodule with a non-trivial topological content, Gabor analysis inputs and uses in Gabor analysis, and a bunch of interesting examples and nice geometrical objects. Maybe also potential use as deep brains in string theory, but this is up to you to find out. Thank you.